Good morning and welcome to Conowingo Baptist Church.
Good morning.
Good morning. It's good to have you all here today. We still got some people coming in. We got kids crawling on the ground. We got good times. Good fun stuff. But we're so thankful to be here together, to be able to worship together. And I want to say thank you for taking the time to come out on the Sunday morning to be with us. And I see some new faces. I see some familiar faces. But it's good to have you all here today. And as we like to do, we like to remind us at the beginning of the worship service, we are here to worship Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. We are here to proclaim His name, to proclaim His gospel. That is the whole purpose, that is the whole reason of why we gather together on days like this, is so that with everything going on around the world, and thankfully there's nothing crazy. Thankfully things are pretty normal right now.
Oh, yeah.
But especially the sarcasm. Right where it should be. But with all the things going on in and around our world, with all the things that we look around and we say, man, things just seem out of whack, we can return back to our God, whether that's through the live stream, through the digital outlets, here in person. We can return to our God and know that He is never changing. That He will sustain us. He is the rock of our salvation. He is immovable. The gospel is unbreakable. And the God that we put our faith in is not going to change and be put off by the things going on around us. Our God saves.
Amen.
Our God cleanses and redeems. And so we can continually go back to Him without worrying about whether or not He's going to be there for us. So our God is always there to deliver us and rescue us from whatever it is that's going on around us. And so we are coming here today to worship Jesus Christ. And as we've gathered back together into the sanctuary, just want to talk again about some of the things we have set up. In the pews, you'll look in the pews and you'll see some tape lines. And in those tape lines, I've shown you that's 7 feet. So if you are in the same family and whatever, you can feel free, like my kids here, they're all shoulder to shoulder. But if you're looking on the other side of the pew, you got 7 feet, that's your social distancing. You can keep that 7 feet between the two of you and know that that is there. The cross is on the ground, that's your 6 feet of social distancing. If you are in this sanctuary, the main part of the sanctuary, we're just going to ask that you use the bathrooms right behind you. If you're over here in the wing, you go out that door, use the bathrooms right back here. That'll just kind of prevent some cross traveling and everything else. If you went into one side of the pew, the outside or the inside, whatever side you came in on, just go out of that same side. That also prevents some cross-pollination, as we call it. And at the very end of the service, we're going to dismiss from the rear of the sanctuary, so that part of the sanctuary first. Get outside, everybody just give. As soon as we're over, everybody just get outside. The virus does not spread very well outside at all, so you're welcome to go outside, talk together, hang out together. You can wear a mask, put your mask on, and be hanging out outside. If you're in the wing, you can use this exit right here. You go right outside, you'll be outside. But we want to exit from the rear to the front of the sanctuary, again, just to give everybody opportunity to maintain that social distancing. Because we are here to worship. We are not here to test our God. We are not here to say, well, God, because we're here, all of a sudden we're all immune to the note. That is not the way that this works. That's why things are taped up. That's why you see something, every other pew is taped off. We want to be wise. We do not want to be foolish. And we absolutely do not want to test our God. That is not honoring to Him at all. So, happy Father's Day. Happy Father's Day. If you are a dad here, we are thankful for the investment that you have poured into your children. We're thankful for the time that you have given to your kids, grandkids. Some of you great grandparents, any great granddads in here? Any great granddads? All right. Teach it to your children and to your children's children the ways of the Lord. And thank you for that investment that you've given to your kids, your grandkids, great grandkids. And it means so much for these little children to hear the truth from these men that love them so much. The same men that are going to push them on the playground and be a little bit rough with them at times, you know, those same men, when they turn around and speak a dear, precious truth into their ear, means the world. And so we recognize that this is a wonderful blessing, but we also recognize that today can be difficult for ones who have lost their fathers, grandfathers, that meant a lot to them, great-grandfathers, and so today can be difficult. And it is in that same heart, as one who lost my father as well, it's in that same heart that we turn to the Scriptures. Isaiah 64, verse 8. But now, O Lord, you are our Father. We are the clay. You are our potter. And all we are the work of your hands. That we have a heavenly Father that we can count on forever and ever and ever. And I was reflecting on this week about this Sunday. I know you may be familiar with it, and I'm definitely familiar with the idea of saying, like, when I pass away, I'm going to see my dad, I'm going to see my mom, I'm going to see the relatives that have all had placed their faith. And I thought about this, and for the first time, the Lord was saying, you're not going to see your dad, you're not going to see your mom, you're going to see your brother, you're going to see your sister. And we're going to have one Heavenly Father that we all get to see. He will be there in heaven. And so just encouragement for you that the relationship, if you have lost that loved one, the relationship that you're going to have in heaven is going to be something far greater and far more important than what we ever had here. And that is also a tremendous joy. We need to pray for our church family, those that are hurting, those that are suffering. Pray for our nation, as has been mentioned earlier today. Pray for our nation and everything they're going through. We need wisdom. And we need the wisdom of the Holy Spirit. We need God in His loving kindness and His wonderful, wonderful healing gospel to start at the very top and to filter its way down. And then for us at the bottom, start at the bottom, filter its way up. We need to be praying for our nation that God would heal it by the blood of Jesus Christ, the forgiveness available through Him and Him alone. But we have members who are struggling. We have members who are having issues, and we need to remember them and pray to our Lord God. If you place a name on my heart, help me to reach out to them. Help me to call them and to pray with them and to tell them I love them, I miss them, and to let them know that they are not forgotten. Let's go to the Lord as we pray and we open this service this morning. Our Father in heaven, you are holy and you are righteous. And you are good. Thank you, Lord, for all that you provide. But thank you, God, for who you are for every single one of us. That it doesn't matter how far we've ran away. We can always turn back to you. We are one choice away from turning back to you and saying, I'm sorry. I'm sorry, God. Forgive me for what I've done. Forgive me for how far I ran. But I'm here today with everything I am. I'm here today for you. And God, you desire all that we are. And you deserve nothing less. You deserve all of our heart, soul, mind, and strength. You deserve all of it. In fact, God, you don't deserve just a piece of it and nothing else. You deserve so much more. So God, if we have been trying to live our life with just a little foot in and maybe a hand in every now and then on Sunday, but the rest of the week we're living however we want, clearly following our own hearts, clearly following the voice of evil. If that is what we've been doing, God, help us to repent today. Help us to turn from that foolishness and to lay it all aside and say, God, no, I'm done right now. I just want you. I want to be in your presence. I want to know that I'm all in. And I want you to know, God, that I'm all in. No more reservations, no more hanging back. I just want to be here with you doing what you're telling me to do. And I'm not going to worry about what people think anymore. God, we don't have time in this world to argue against you. The world needs to hear the gospel. And the world is only going to hear it from your people. So, Father God, we pray to be emboldened with your word today. Give us your Holy Spirit as we sing these songs and play these instruments. We pray for your protection and mercy in regard to COVID-19. Without you, God, we are helpless. Without our potter, this clay will just be a lump. But you are our Heavenly Father, and you make good things, strong things. You make pieces of pottery that will last and endure. So build us up today. Shape us by your word. Shape us by the worship and the song and the prayer. We love you, God, and we dedicate this entire day to you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let's stand and sing together a song we love.
Sometimes on this journey, get lost in my mistakes.
story straight. My story isn't over. My story's just begun. Failure won't define me, 'cause that's what my father does. Failure won't define me, 'cause that's what my father does. The burdens, everything that we have brought into this place, I pray that we would lay them down at your feet this morning, and that we would focus on you and your word, and that we would be changed just a little bit more like you when we leave. I pray that your word would go out, and we know it goes out with power. And Father, I pray that the hearts would be receptive, that they would be open, and that your spirit would be moving already. And it is in your awesome and great name, Yeshua Jesus, that we pray. Amen. It's the name of Jesus this morning that we praise. It's the name of Jesus from our sins. It is the name of Jesus that carries power. We're gonna sing of His great name.
Lost to save, find their way at the sound of Your great name. All condemned, feel no shame at the sound of Your.
Your great name.
Today, we're looking at our second sermon in a series called I Pray, O God of Israel. The title of the message today is Here in Heaven, Your Dwelling Place. Here in Heaven, Your Dwelling Place. We're going to be in 1 Kings chapter 8, verses 37 through 54. And so if you can turn in your Bibles to 1 Kings chapter 8, we're going to read in verses 37 through 54. Here in heaven, O God of Israel, I pray. That worthy is the Lamb who was slain is a song that we will be joining together. Every time we sing it, we are joining together with the heavenly hosts. Sing, worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. And so we remember that this God in heaven, this heavenly host that surrounds him, you and I get to sing and praise and worship. In spirit and in truth, we are aligning with all those who are singing right now. Powerful. Let's read together verse beginning in 37 of 1 Kings chapter 8. When there is famine in the land, pestilence or blight or mildew, locusts or grasshoppers, when their enemy besieges them in the land of their cities, whatever plague or whatever sickness there is, whatever prayer, whatever supplication is made by anyone or by all your people Israel, when each one knows the plague of his own heart and spreads out his hands toward this temple, then hear in heaven your dwelling place and forgive and act and give to everyone according to all his ways, whose heart you know. For you alone know the hearts of all the sons of men, that they may fear you all the days that they live in the land which you gave to our fathers. Moreover, concerning a foreigner who is not of your people Israel, but has come from a far country for your name's sake, for they will hear of your great name and your strong hand and your outstretched arm. When he comes and prays toward this temple, hear in heaven your dwelling place, and do according to all for which the foreigner calls to you, that all peoples of the earth may know your name and fear you, as do your people Israel, and that they may know that this temple which I built is called by your name. When your people go out to battle against their enemy, wherever you send them, and when they pray to Yahweh toward the city which you have chosen and the temple which I have built for your name, then hear in heaven their prayer and their supplication and maintain their cause. And when they sin against you, for there is no one who does not sin, and you become angry with them and deliver them to the enemy, and they take them captive to the land of the enemy, far or near, yet when they come to themselves in the land where they were carried captive and repent and make supplication to you in the land of those who took them captive, saying, we have sinned and done wrong, we have committed wickedness, and when they return to you with all their heart, with all their soul, in the land of their enemies who led them away captive, and pray to you toward their land which you gave to their fathers, the city which you have chosen, the temple which I have built for your name, then hear in heaven your dwelling place, their prayer and their supplication, and maintain their cause. And forgive your people who have sinned against you and all their transgressions which they transgressed against you, and grant them compassion before those who took them captive, that they may have compassion on them. For they are your people and your inheritance, whom you brought out of Egypt, out of the iron furnace, that your eyes may be opened to the supplication of your servant and the supplication of your people Israel, to listen to them whenever they call to you. For you separated them from among all the peoples of the earth to be your inheritance, as you spoke by your servant Moses when you brought our fathers out of Egypt, O Lord God, or O Adonai Yahweh. And so it was, when Solomon had finished praying all this prayer and supplication to Yahweh, that he arose from before the altar of Yahweh, from kneeling on his knees with his hands spread up to heaven. Let's pray together. Our Father in heaven, our loving God, and our redeeming Christ, Let us see your truth right now. Let us know for certain what it is that you desire for all of your people to pray about right now, at this day, at this time, in this age. What do we need to be praying about? And what is our motive, and where should our hearts be as we cry out and we give these prayers to you, God? There's an infinite amount of things we could be praying for. Things we could be asking for. But God, your word will direct us where we need to pray. So let us be serious this morning about your word. Let us take it to heart. And Father God, let us not just be hearers of the word, but doers of the word. In Jesus' name we pray for your blessing on this message. Let it be your words. Amen. You may be seated. So the first section we're going to look at is, hear all who suffer. Hear all who suffer. We want our God to hear in heaven, his dwelling place, and we want him to hear all who suffer. This is verses 37 through 40. And we're continuing to read here. What we're reading is a prayer of King Solomon, the wisest king in all the land, the wisest king in all of history. This wise king is giving a prayer, and he's showing us this is his heart. And it begins here. It says, when there's famine in the land, pestilence or blight, mildew, locusts, grasshoppers, when their enemy besieges them in the land of their cities, whatever plague or whatever sickness there is. Well, back in verse 31, we saw that Solomon, King Solomon, we saw this last week, he started to describe these series of scenarios. If you remember, we had a couple scenarios last week, a few of them. Well, this week we're going to look at scenarios 4 through 7. So he gives individual scenarios. And when this kind of thing happens, he says, and then we respond by praying to you, then can you make this happen? Can you bring this result? And so this is what he's saying. He's asking for God in heaven, when these things happen, we pray to you. He's saying, God, can you answer? Can you step in and can you do this? And so we're hearing this. Scenario number 4 now. So we saw 3 scenarios last week. We're looking at scenario number 4. And this is a prayer for when God's people are struck with a variety of calamities. Famine. Pestilence. Blight. That is, things are just set on fire. Scorching fire. Mildew. Things are rotting. Locusts. Coming and devouring. Grasshoppers. And enemies. What have we seen across our nation as of late? All of us. There are people who are non-believers who are joking about how this really looks and sounds like the end of days. If lost people are recognizing this, then we as the church better believe it too. If it's so plain and obvious to them, then we are no longer in a condition where we can say, oh, I'm just going to ignore it. Maybe this is something else. I've been using this term lately. If nothing else, let's just recognize these are the Braxton Hicks, that the end is coming. There's some labor pains happening. We've got to be a people, church, who are ready for the things that Revelation speaks about. Losing our church building for 3 months is a warning that this is what it will look like in the end permanently. You will lose your church. Do you still have the heart to fellowship with your God? You will lose your Bibles. Do you have it here? Do you have it here? Have you memorized it that you can still tell it? Shortages in our grocery stores, locusts, murder, hornets, cities set on fire, the plague and sickness of the coronavirus, COVID-19, a variety of calamities, which means that this prayer directly relates to our nation's situation. It's amazing how this verse ends with this all-inclusive statement, in case we missed it, whatever plague, whatever sickness there is. when these things happen, not if. We are not the first nation. This is not the first time in history these kinds of things have happened. And every time they happen, it is a reminder for us, it's just going to get worse. It's just going to get louder. These things will continue to happen. And when they happen, what should be our response? Verse 38, then he says, whatever prayer, whatever supplication is made by anyone or by all your people, when each one knows the plight of his own heart, spreads out his hands toward this temple. What should we do when these things happen? We pray, church. We don't argue. We don't get into divisive discussions that don't mean anything. Nonsensical, totally rooted in physical things in this world. We don't get into those ridiculous discussions. And we certainly don't start fighting against each other and backbiting one another within this house. We pray. We take it to our God in heaven and we say, God, you've got to heal this thing. You've got to step in here. Because without you, we are hopeless. Without you, it's not a drought I'm concerned about, Lord. Whatever prayer. Do you have to be a graduate from a Bible college? Do you have to be an ordained minister? Do you have to have been saved and done a bunch of work in the church for years? Nope. Whatever prayer, whatever supplication. He says, it's made by anyone or by all. Anyone can pray, but every one of us ought to. Every one of us needs to. What qualifies us to pray? This might be the challenging part. This might be the part that kind of gets us off a little bit. He says, each one who knows the plague of his own heart. Didn't he just say, what about the plagues and the pestilences and all these things start happening all around us? But then what does he say? When they see the plague of their own heart, God, hear their prayer. I've said it before. Nobody made us take our Bibles and our prayers out of school. We chose to do that. That was a plague of our own heart, of a bunch of born-again believers telling their kids they're not allowed to do these things anymore in school because they were afraid of what people might say. They were afraid of what teachers might do, what the politicians might say. They were afraid of what that's politically incorrect. You can't do that anymore. That was a plague of our own heart. We have had 3 months of clear evidence that God is not okay with how we're doing business in this nation. 3 months. And how often have you personally given the testimony that Jesus Christ is the cure for this world? If we have not done that, that's a plague in our own heart. We haven't cared enough. We haven't loved them enough to say this is the real solution. That's a plague in our own heart. When we recognize the plague in our own heart, then God says, when they do it, then hear their prayer. So here's a great truth for us today. We need to start praying to our God for Him to heal what's going on right here first. That's the prayer He wants to hear. Because we're really good at pointing at everybody else and saying, I can't believe they did that. I can't believe they're doing that. They're setting stuff on fire. If they really knew what they were supposed to be protesting, I know what we've been thinking. But what God wants us to do is say, yeah. But what's going on in here, Josh? That's what they're choosing to do in the dark when they feel like nobody's watching. And it's wrong. But Josh, what are you choosing to do when no one's watching? What are you thinking when no one's around? What do you, Josh, what do you think you're getting away with because you don't think it's on camera? Let's deal with that, Josh. And all of a sudden, I'm like, okay, God. They're not so bad. Give them grace, God. Show them with grace. All of a sudden, we see what they need. When we're on an airplane, and we have the opening, the stewardesses or stewards are telling us, say, this is what you are supposed to do when there's an emergency, right? The mask comes down, and if we're with a child or an adult or someone disabled, who gets the mask first? Do we put it on them or do we put it on ourselves? Ourselves. Why? Because we can't help them until we've got there here. It does no good with the best of intentions to reach down to our little ones and try to put the mask on and then faint while we're trying to put the mask on because we don't have the air we need. Are you getting what I'm saying? We need to be breathing in the Spirit of God. We need to be going to His Word and saying, God, what is wrong here? Here's my problem here. God, give me the solution here. And as He feeds us here, only then can we turn around and say, oh, I've got air now. I've got the breath that I need. And by the power of the Holy Spirit, I can see now. Let me go and help this person and recognize that if I didn't have my mask, I'd be dead too. I need to help them now that God has helped me. If we are not healed by the plague of our own heart, how can we be awake and alert enough to administer the masks to others? And it won't matter how genuinely good our intentions are. We cannot be 100% effective in the kingdom of God until His Spirit fills us and cleanses our hearts and cleanses our minds to then go and minister to others. So anyone can pray. Every one of us can pray. Every one of us can spread our hands up to the heavens as an act of submission and faith. And so when we do that, verse 39, he says, then hear in heaven your dwelling place and forgive and act and give to everyone according to all his ways whose heart you know. For you alone know the hearts of all the sons of men. We need God to step in and act. To hear, forgive, act, and give. Hear God. Forgive these things. Notice you don't get to the actions and the giving until you go through the forgiveness. Church, our God needs to know that we recognize we've sinned against Him and we need forgiveness. We need forgiveness and then He can then act and give and do the other things around the world that we need Him to do right now. But we need forgiveness. You say, well, I already got forgiveness at the cross and resurrection. We did, but God wants us to continually go to Him and say, yeah, God, I know I'm forgiven permanently, but you also know I sinned like today. And God, you need me to say that to you because you know it's true and I know it's true. You just want to hear it from my lips. I've sinned against you. I'm sorry. Give according to His ways. Do you notice that? We do not want God to give us according to our ways until we've been forgiven of our ways. Does that make sense? Forgive, act, give according to all His ways. And yet we actually are supposed to be a people who can look to God and say, God, can you give us according to our ways? You've forgiven me, you've cleansed me, you've set me off now on a journey, and I want to do what you're telling me to do, and I want you to give me according to my ways. There is a boldness, a real, true blue zeal that will come in the name of the Lord when we are living righteously for Him. And until we have that righteousness of living for Him, the way He's telling us to live, you know what we tend to do? We tend to cower away, afraid, because we know that we're actually guilty. We know we're not living the way that God wants us to. And so we can't stand out there and say, proclaim, no, Jesus is the way. We worry about that when we're living in sin. And so God says, no, okay, so the right way to do this, recognize the plague in your heart, cry out to God, receive the forgiveness, and then get out there and get the job done. Have you considered what God might actually be withholding in His answers to our prayers based on our own personal disobedience to His Word? Have you thought about that? There could be prayers out there that He is just waiting and ready to answer powerfully, immediately waiting to answer, and He's just waiting for us to be obedient to His Word. Let's say someone wanted to ride a bike, like a bicycle. They want to go on a 50-mile journey. They're like, I'm going to ride a bicycle. I'm going to go 50 miles on this bicycle. So they go, they purchase an awesome bicycle, and they say, I'm going to train, I'm going to do all this, and that night right before they train, right, the night before the first training day, like, I'm going to prepare myself, I'm going to ride this bike, I'm going to do 50 miles. That night before the training day, they get down on their knees, and they pray, God, if you could just give me the strength and the ability to train and to get through this 50 miles and in one day maybe even 100 miles. Man, I can just see myself doing some great things. God, can you help that? And then the very next day they get up, they take the chain off their bike and they toss it out in the woods. And then they get up on that bike and they've got the helmet. They look real good and they're wearing the dorky skin tight suits. And they get on there and they're pedaling away. And And they have to leave the kickstand down now because the chain's not connected, the bike's not going to move. So they put the kickstand down, and they're just pedaling, and they're sweating, and they're grueling, and they're just pedaling, pedaling, pedaling. And then they're just like, man, I don't know what's going on. So they get back down on their knees again the next night, and they pray and they ask God, God, I believe in you. I believe who you are. I believe in your power, but you didn't really answer my prayer. So I'm going to get up tomorrow. I'm going to train again. They get up tomorrow. The chain's still broken. The chain's still off. Kickstand is still down, and they pedal away, not moving an inch. This is what it's like for the one who prays for things and they know in their heart they're not following Jesus as Lord and Savior. Their day-to-day routine is not actually chained in, linked in with the Holy Spirit and His demands and His requirements and His kingdom. And yet we get on there and we work and we work and we work and we work and we feel like nothing's moving, nothing's changing. And we have not linked up with the Holy Spirit of God to say, God, there are things I'm being disobedient in, and I'm going to stop throwing the chain away. I'm going to recognize that this is an integral part of your kingdom, that I be obedient in this area, and I haven't been doing it. He says, whose hearts you know, because you alone know the hearts of all. These parenthetical statements that are going to be attached to each of these scenarios, these little parentheses, there's sermons in each of these parentheses. If you've still got a Bible where you highlight or you take notes, whatever, every parenthesis, just put a highlight in there, put a little note in there, like, look into this. For you alone know the hearts of all. God knows our hearts. He sees and He understands our obedience as well as our disobedience. And so Solomon's praying on behalf of all who would ask the Lord for obedience, knowing that Yahweh God is going to give the desires of our hearts, but He's also going to give it according to obedience, as we are obedient or disobedient to you. In verse 40, that they may fear you all the days that they live in the land which you gave to our fathers. So why would the answers of, like the answered prayers of the righteous, why would that bring fear? He says that it would bring fear in the land. When the God of the universe, the invisible God who created everything, when He actually steps into our life and answers a prayer, and like there's no denying that He did it, that is a fearful thing. Not just fear as in like the sense of being afraid, but it's a reverence. It's a deep, deep connection of reverence that also has like a tinge of fear in it. He's like, wait a minute, He's real. He can do these things. He actually does it. Joan, we praise the Lord for what God did with Sarah, right? That was an unbelievable thing. She was wrecked and broken. No feeling, right? Incredible when the God of the universe hears our prayer steps and does something. We're like, God did that? He doesn't always do it, but when He does it, there's a bit of like, whoa. That they may fear you all the days that they live. If you and I can learn how to fear Yahweh better, fear God better, it'll help us in our reverence to be obedient tomorrow. To be obedient right now. Why aren't we living in obedience constantly? Because we don't fear the Lord our God. But He truly does forgive, He truly does act, and He truly does give when we pray to Him in our seasons of plagues and suffering. Concluding point number one, hear all who suffer. God forgives, He acts, and He gives. God forgives, acts, and gives. He does hear us, and He does respond. Section number two, hear all who travel. Hear all who travel. Verse 41. Moreover, concerning a foreigner who is not of your people Israel, but has come from a far country for your name's sake. If you notice in this prayer, this is extremely timely for what's going on in our nation right now. Because what is happening in our nation is this underlying racial prejudice, this underlying thing that is there. It's not there with everybody, but it's definitely there for some. There's some people who are black, there are people who are white who don't like black who don't like white. It's real, it's there, and the Lord is just bringing it up to the surface. And saying, let's deal with this, and let's be done with it. And what we're seeing in this prayer is that as Solomon is being led by the Holy Spirit, he's saying, I don't care if they are foreign. If they're coming to Jesus, I don't care what they look like. Let them come. This is not about whether we tolerate people who look different. It's about whether or not we love them. And we could put all the happy, fluffy pictures and gifts on Facebook and Instagram and Twitter. We could put all the wonderful, great quotes. But God is looking at our heart. Do I love black people? Do I love brown people? Do I love white people? Or do I just love people created in the image of God? Do I just love them all and I really don't care what they look like or sound like to me?
Amen.
This scenario number 5 is Solomon praying that the foreigner who's come from a far country. And so, you know, people travel for all sorts of reasons, but this is a specific type of foreigner. It's somebody who's traveled for your name's sake, he says. What a great prayer request. Lifting up those who may not look or sound like us, but they're looking to the same God as us. So how are these foreigners hearing about Yahweh? Because God's works are worthy of praise and it will spread. It says, verse 42, for they will hear of your great name and your strong hand and your outstretched arm. When he comes and prays towards this temple, they're going to hear. They're going to hear. Are you living a life that is noteworthy in the kingdom of God? Are you living a life that other people would see it and say, wow, I can't believe Jesus can do that. I've got to go tell my friends. I've got to call people. I've got to let people know that Jesus can do this kind of thing. Are you living that kind of life? The only way we live that kind of life is fear and reverence of our God. Obedience to His commandments and living all for Him. But this is what Solomon was banking on. They're going to hear about what you did. They're going to hear your great name. Your great name, why am I keep saying Yahweh in this place of Lord? In your Bible, the front of your Bible, it'll say Lord, all capital letters. Or it'll say God, all capital letters. This is God's name, Yahweh, eternally self-existent. This is His name, your great name, your strong hand. That's His power. His name is Yahweh. His power is His strong hand. Your outstretched arm, that's effort. Amber and I know all too well it takes an outstretched arm at any grocery store to get those groceries on the time. It's effort. If we don't have a stool, we are climbing. But when you outstretch your arm, have you ever done that? You ever, like, something is right out of your reach and you're like on your tippy toes reaching outstretched arm? That's effort! He's speaking about a God who cares enough about us to put His effort into our salvation. Isn't that something? Isn't that glorious? So how does this relate today? There are people who may seem foreign to us, but they have heard and they have placed their faith in the same God as all of us. This past week, Tony Haywood and I were invited out to go to an Amish community and share our testimony to an Amish community. And Brother Junie went with us. There's about 50 or 60 young people, 17 to 20 years old, something like that, 22 years old. And they were all sitting there and they came to hear us give a testimony about addiction and about the things of the world and how they have nothing to offer us. Tony gave his testimony, I gave my testimony, we both gave our testimony, and we were real with them. But they just received us in. Because they believe in the same fundamental truths that we believe in here. It's the same God. Same faith. Same God with the same name. As I said, Jesus, the God of the universe who came down to die for us. They said amen. They knew who we were talking about. When we said the same strong hand, we talk about His nail-scarred hands, they knew what we were talking about. Same outstretched arm, Jesus' sacrificial death on the cross, the Lamb who was slain, who is worthy of all praise and all glory, all honor. They've heard the same gospel, they trusted in the same hope that we all have. And when I sat down with them, yes, their hair was different. Yes, they acted different, sounded different, dressed differently. But you know what was the exact same? The Holy Spirit of Yahweh God. I'm sitting there and I was with my brothers and sisters in Christ. And there was no doubt in my mind. And when they sang, it sounded like an angelic chorus. Beautiful, beautiful sound. They want us to come and hear them sing. I don't love that to happen. Why am I saying this? Because Solomon's praying for the foreigner who comes and travels and prays to the same God, that their prayer requests would be answered. How often do we pray that other born-again believers, that their prayer requests would also get answered? God, hear their prayers too. Hear the prayers of Porter's Grove Baptist Church, God. Hear the prayers of Wrightsdale Baptist Church, God. Hear the prayers of that church that hurt me all those years ago. But there are born-again believers there, so I don't care if they hurt me. Hear their prayers too, God, because we're one family. So what do we pray for as the full family of God? Verse 43, hear in heaven your dwelling place and do according to all of which the foreigner calls to you, that all peoples on earth may know your name and fear you as do your people Israel, that they may know that this temple which I've built is called by your name. We want everyone on earth to hear about God, right? We want everyone on earth to hear about what Jesus did. And that's what he's saying. You hear their prayers, God, do what they're asking, so everyone on the earth is going to know your name and they're going to learn to fear you too. We want the salvation of everyone, right? Well, if I'm not mistaken, you and I aren't going to do it ourselves. We need our brothers and sisters in Christ being faithful where God's called them so that they can give the gospel where they're at too. It's a team effort. When all of God's people are having their prayers answered, the whole world can take notice and realize that there really is a true God in heaven. So what happened when Yahweh God brought his people out of Egypt? The world took notice. The nations noticed. Wow, people who were enslaved, they're now free. When God sees, or when people see what God does with dead people, bringing them back to life, people take notice. Other people take notice. I can't believe what I just saw. I know this person BC, and I know this person now AD, and they don't match up, and so I've got to figure out what just happened. So this is what it says, verse 44. When your people go out to battle against their enemy, wherever you send them, and when they pray to Yahweh toward the city which you have chosen and the temple which I built for your name. This is now scenario number six, all right? Scenario number six, people, God's people going out to war. So there's three things to remember about combat, and combat we can see here. First is the battle is against the enemy, not against each other. We were never intended to go to battle against each other. The enemy is Satan and his demons. That's the enemy. And as we see, oftentimes we look at the Old Testament and say, man, why was it like, why was there so much violence and all that in the Old Testament? The New Testament seems like God's just nice and friendly. The Old Testament is a physical picture of a spiritual truth. All the battle that we saw going on in the Old Testament is a picture of all the spiritual battle that goes on all the time. And yes, God is at war against spiritual beings who are against his kingdom. He is at war against Satan and his demons, which means you and I are too. And we're either in the battle actively or we are passively losing this battle. The church is your family, not your enemy. No matter what actions any of us do which might divide us, it can never erase the act that actually binds us, which is the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ. Second is the battle is where God sends us, not wherever we choose to fight. We are really good at picking our own fights. We're really good at standing up and fighting aggressively and defending aggressively things that we want to fight about. But how often do we say, God, where are you sending me right now? Which camp do you want me to be in right now? Where do you want me to go and take up residence to sit and to do a spiritual fight for you, God? Where are you sending me? We're not so good at that, are we? We're good about seeing something and saying, oh, I've got to give my 2 cents here. I've got to give my opinion. We're not so good about saying, God, where would you have me go today? What would you have me say? The church is to follow the Holy Spirit of Christ in the battle for the salvation of souls. Ephesians 6:12, we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly places. Are we serious, church, about invisible warfare going on around us? Or are we more serious about political warfare going on around us? Only the Holy Spirit knows where the demonic strongholds are, and therefore only the Spirit can lead us to engage in those areas. But how do we win? The third point of combat here is that the battle is the Lord's. The battle is Yahweh's. It's not ours. He says, when they pray to Yahweh. We pray to Yahweh God during our battles because the victory of the battle belongs to Him. Solomon's dad, David, before he was king, he was a little shepherd boy, and he had the same kind of faith. Listen to this warning that David gave to Goliath as he was about to go to battle against him. 1 Samuel 17:47. He says, then all of this assembly shall know that Yahweh does not save with sword or spear, for the battle is the Lord's. The battle is Yahweh's, and He will give you into our hands. And He said this right before He cut Goliath's head off. We are not going to win with the physical things in this world. We can't trust the physical things to save us and rescue us. The battle belongs to Yahweh God. We need to believe that He's already got the victory. We need to get in line with His boldness. Think about what David was saying. A 9-foot-tall giant standing in front of him. And he's saying, I'm not going to beat you with a spear or a sword. That's not how I'm going to win. I'm going to beat you because this battle belongs to the Lord. And He's going to win. So let's get it done. And he didn't just pray and then sit down and hope that something would just happen. He prayed and then he got up and he did what God was telling him to do. We need to be doers of the word, not just hearers. Pray for the foreigner that God would hear their prayer. Pray for the spiritual battles that we have going on that God would hear and answer. The only chance we have for victory in our battles is for Yahweh God to give it into our hands. This is why Solomon said, the temple which I built for your name, so that Yahweh's name gets all the glory, all the honor, because He has all the power. Verse 45, then hear in heaven their prayer, their supplication, and maintain their cause. In this battle scenario, the request that he gives, maintain their cause. You know what that means? It literally means make justice. That's what it means to maintain their cause. In the original language, it means, God, I want you to make justice here. That is God looking at the situation and executing things in a way that are right. So that the world would be more righteous after God wins than it was before he put the victory in. We need to pray that God would make justice in this world. Not justice the way we see it, justice the way He sees it. We must never lose focus on what we're here for and why we do what we do. We exist as the church to be used by Jesus as He seeks and saves the lost. Concluding point number 2, hear all who travel, God's name maintains the cause. It's His own being that will bring justice. It is His own personhood. It is God Almighty who makes these things continue on the way they are. And so if we call out to His name, we trust in who He is, we don't have to worry about whether there's going to be victory or not. He will maintain the cause. Section number 3, the final section today, hear all who return. Verse 46, when they sin against you, for there is no one who does not sin. There's no one who does not sin. When they sin against you and you become angry with them and deliver them to the enemy and they take them captive to the land of the enemy far or near. This is scenario 7 of 7 within this prayer of Solomon. It's involved, it's instructive, we're going to go through it, but it begins with a sin against Yahweh God, breaking His law. And we notice the parenthetical statement, there's no one who does not sin. We need to remember that. That puts us all on equal ground. Yes, we are all made in His image, but sadly, yes, we also take God's image and we choose to break His law. We've all done that. We are all sinners, and we need grace. 1 John 1:8-10. If we say that we have no sin, he says, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say that we have not sinned, we make him a liar, and his word is not in us. I have met people. I used to think, well, are you a sinner? I expected people to say, of course I'm a sinner, I've sinned. I have met people who said, I really am not a sinner. I don't sin. Really? Yeah, I don't. I don't sin. Really? Really? So, do you ever look at somebody and with lust in your heart? You ever thought something about somebody that you didn't like them and you didn't want to have anything to do with them anymore? Yeah, of course, everybody does that.
Everybody sins.
Sin. It's murder in your heart. It's lust. It's adultery in your heart. Everybody sins. So we all sin, but we don't all confess our sins and seek forgiveness. We don't all do that. And that leads to this next portion of the scenario. He says, and you become angry at them and deliver them to the enemy. When we sin and we refuse to repent, it angers our God. Why? Why does God get angry? I've heard this argument too from atheists and agnostics. Why would God actually ever get angry? He's powerful, he's all powerful, he just changed what he wants. Why would he actually get angry? Because instead of us, who, if we've been born again, we place our faith in Jesus, the blood has covered us, we are resurrected from the dead, right? So we were dead and we're alive in Christ. And instead of us being used in the fight against Satan and his demons, when we choose sin and we choose the habit of sin, we are actively fighting against Yahweh God and his kingdom. You know what we call that in our modern terminology? Treason. Sin is spiritual treason against our King Jesus. That's why he gets angry. When you and I hear about a traitor, right, in the United States, we hear about somebody who sold us out to some foreign government. When we hear about that traitor, what do we immediately feel? Anger! You sold us out! We were your people, man, and you sold us out! Our God looks at us when we sin, and he's saying, you're my people, and you're selling me out. You're committing treason. You're acting like a traitor. What should happen to a traitor? He says, take them captive to the land of the enemy, far and near. The consequence of choosing sin is the reality of captivity and the principles that go along with that. Why do we feel distant from the Lord when we're in the habit of sinning? Why do we feel controlled by sin when we've given our heart over to it? Because God disciplines us to feel the spiritual truths underlying his law. He says sin leads to death. Sin will hold you captive. If you sin, I will send you away. I will let you be a captive to the enemy that you want to serve. That's why we feel distant from God when we sin. Sin is an act of treason that runs direct opposition to the promises of God. But does God want us to just stay in captivity? No. He just wants us to know that captivity is real. He wants us to know you and I don't have any authority over sin. Only Jesus does. So he wants us to know what that's like. But he says, verse 47, and yet when they come to themselves in the land where they were carried captive and repent, make supplication to you in the land of those who took them captive, saying, we have sinned and done wrong. We have committed wickedness. So here's where we start seeing some repentance. They come to themselves. We come to our mind. We realize and recognize, I'm sinning, and this is horrible for me. When we return to our right mind and our right heart for Jesus, we will need to say, we've sinned and we've done wrong. We've committed wickedness. And I want you to recognize those three ideas are three ideas. Sin, breaking God's law. We have done wrong. That means we could have been right, but we chose the wrong thing. And we committed wickedness. And I think this third element is what usually keeps us from true repentance. Because we think our sin isn't really that bad. But God says, no, it's wicked. It's evil. You're acting like a fallen angel. You're acting like Satan himself when you choose to sin. It's wicked and foul and wrong. That's how our God needs us to see it. Every sin. Each and every sin. There is no sin that we are okay with that God's okay with. He says it's wicked. It's evil. We need to admit our guilt and accept the condemnation that ought to come with that and say, God, thank you for the grace that I'm not getting that. Therefore, help me stop. It's not just about the what in the act of sin. It's about the why. Verse 48, when they return to you with all their heart, with all their soul in the land of their enemies, who led them away captive, and pray to you toward their land, which you gave to their fathers, the city which you've chosen, the temple which I built for your name, return to you with all their heart, with all their soul. When we break God's most primary and important commandment, we're doing it with our heart and with our soul. Deuteronomy 6:5, you shall love the Lord your God, you shall love Yahweh your God with all your heart, with all your soul, all your strength. Why does God want us to love Him with everything that we are? Why does God want that? Because He has loved us first with everything that He is. He didn't love us with a piece of Himself. He loved us with all of Himself. And this is why, see, some of us here and some of us listening, we may not even know why God is worthy to return to. If we're lost and we don't even know God, we're not going to know, why would I want to return to Him? What does He have to offer? He tells us. So Deuteronomy 6:5, right? You shall love Yahweh God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. Then it says Deuteronomy 7:7-8, He gives the why. Why should we do that? Listen to what God says. This is His motives towards us. This is our God's heart. If you want to know God's heart towards you and wanting us to love Him, He says, Yahweh did not set His love on you nor choose you because you were more in number than any other people. For you are the least of all peoples. But because Yahweh loves you and because He would keep the oath which He swore to your fathers, Yahweh has brought you out with a mighty hand and redeemed you from the house of bondage, from the hand of Pharaoh, king of Egypt. God doesn't extend His love to us because you and I are really good at impressing Him. He loves us because He is love, and He chose to redeem us from bondage. So what does that mean for all of us? It means that He's worthy of returning to because His love rescues us. That's why we ought to return to Him. He is safe and good to come back to all the time because all He wants for us is to be saved. Verse 49, when we do that and have that heart, here in heaven your dwelling place, and hear their supplication, maintain their cause. Verse 50, forgive your people who have sinned against you and all their transgressions, which they transgressed against you, and grant them compassion before those who took them captive, that they may have compassion on them. This ties back to that idea that we need to ask Him to forgive us before we expect to see anything in return. We've got to repent before we expect anything to change. But look, once we repent, now we can pray, God, now change the hearts of the captives who have got me locked up. And this release of guilt, God brings that peace between us and Him. And when we are at peace with Him, He acts on our behalf. Grant them compassion before those who took them captive. See, once God's people deal with the plague in our own hearts, God will then change the minds and hearts of those who oppress us. We look out in the streets, we look out in politics, we look out in racial injustice, we look at all these areas and say, God, change them. God looks back at us and says, I got to change right here. You get a change right here and we can start praying about changing them. Verse 51, for they are your people, your inheritance, whom you brought out of Egypt, out of the iron furnace. Another parenthetical statement, and gives an explanation of truth. What's the purpose of praying for God and telling Him something that He already knows? He says, right, He's praying, He's saying, we're your people, we're your inheritance. It's not so that we can teach God, it's so God can know that He's taught us something. So that we can remember who He is and what He did to save us and bring us out of bondage. Solomon was recognizing that Yahweh had saved Israel from bondage, from that iron furnace. That is bars and fire. That's what our God rescued us from. And He is going to do it again. Verse 52, that your eyes may be open to the supplication of your servant, the supplication of your people Israel, to listen to them whenever they call to you. I want you to notice the language here because it says, I want your eyes to be open so you can listen. I think we all know that we are far less likely to pay attention to somebody speaking to us if we're not looking at them, right? If we're looking away, if we're distracted, we got our phones, we got our devices, we got our iPads, whatever it is. If we're looking away, we're distracted, and somebody might be talking, we're not really listening to them. Or the TV's on, and somebody's talking. I'm horrible about this. If I'm not looking somebody in the eyes, I'm not listening. Usually. And so what he's saying is praying, God, can you look at us? I'm praying, God, can you look down and see me? So I know if you're looking at me, you're listening. This isn't a judgment against God. It's a recognition. This is how communication works. We need our God to look at us right now, church. Which means that we need to clean out the leaven so that we're ready for Him to look at us, right? We need to be ready for an inspection. It's one of my least favorite activities in the Marine Corps. Inspection. But what we knew was inspection day's coming. They're coming. You might want to be ready. We ought to want our God to look at us and be real with Him and let Him deal with all the sin and stuff that we have going on so that He can continually look at us and not be like judging and having to fix us and carry us captive, but looking at us and saying, okay, good. All right, today, we're ready today to go do the work I need to do. Good. I don't have to spend the first 5 hours fixing it. We can just look at, okay, you're doing what I'm asking you to do. Okay, no, you're not perfect. You've admitted that. You've confessed your sins. Let's get out there and get the job done. God wants us to know that we're crying out to a God who has no limits to His mercy and His long-suffering. Wherever they call to you, there's no limit to the where we're at when God can call us back. No limit whatsoever. Verse 53, for you separated them from among all the peoples of the earth to be your inheritance as you spoke to your servant Moses when he brought our fathers out of Egypt, O Adonai Yahweh. And then the final verse, and so it was. When Solomon had finished praying all his prayer and supplication to Yahweh, he arose from before the altar of Yahweh, from kneeling on his knees, with his hands spread up to heaven. He prays this prayer recognizing who he was. We're a people that were in captivity. You separated us out, God. You brought us out. Thank you. He gets done praying, and now we see he was kneeling. If you were here last week, I made a statement our worship ought to look and sound a lot like Old Testament worship. Because the same spirit in them is the same spirit guiding us today. When we went to the Amish community this last week, they said, okay, at the end of our service today, tonight, we're all going to get down on our knees in front of the chairs. And we're going to be squatting down on our knees, and we're going to give a prayer together. And they said, you don't have to do that. There's some people that see that, they think it's weird. We understand you don't have to do that. And so I told Ike, I told his wife and the family there, I said, look, I said, I just preached a sermon on Sunday saying we need to look and sound like Old Testament believers who kneeled down or got on their face or raised their hands to the sky. And we just need to do that. And so I can't preach it on Sunday and then just ignore it during the rest of the week. I said, we're going to be down on our knees, right? Like, it's going to happen. And I've got horrible knees. Horrible knees. Arthritis through all of them. Getting down, it takes twice as long for me to get up. But the posture that Solomon took was a reflection of where his heart was that day. Knees on the ground, hands spread to the heavens, complete submission. Being in a physical posture like that can sometimes help us to remember where we actually are with our Lord. The portion of prayer that we've read today has been from the heart of a king who desperately desired for his God to hear anyone and everyone that was willing to cry out to him for healing in his nation. That is our prayer for our nation as well. What do you need God to hear in heaven, his dwelling place, and to do on our behalf? What do you need God to hear in regard to that prayer? What are you seeking out for God to do for all those who would cry out to Him? This is the question for today. Concluding point number 3, hear all who hear. God grants compassion to captives. There are people captive in sin and they have no idea how to get out. You and I know that Jesus can rescue them. You and I know that Jesus can break those bonds. Are we ready today, at this time of invitation, are we ready today to cry out to our God, to lift our hands up, to kneel down if He tells us to kneel down, to lay down on our face if He tells us to lay down, to stand up and praise if that's what He tells us to do? Are we ready today to take the posture and to take the heart and attitude of our God and say, God, I am not going to be restricted by what people might think about me if I do what you tell me to do. I'm just going to do what you tell me to do because I need you to hear in heaven and answer this prayer, God. Are you ready to do that today? Let's stand up together for this time of invitation. And let's go to the Lord. Father God, you have given us a prayer today. We don't even have to wonder what to pray today. We saw it. We see it from your Holy Spirit. This is the prayer for a nation that's dealing with pestilence, that's dealing with fires, that's dealing with anger and division and separation, that's dealing with sin, sin even in the hearts of your own people, that's dealing with plagues in our own hearts that we've got to deal with, we've got to see and recognize. Father, we see this prayer and we say today, God, just give me the words and I'll lift it up. There are some, God, who may be captive right now and they didn't know they could be saved. They thought they were too far. But you say you'll hear wherever we are, however far we go, you can hear and you'll answer. Lord, during this invitation, please speak to us. Help us be obedient to you. All those that you're calling up here to the altar to pray and to cry these things out. If somebody needs to talk about salvation or talk about baptism and what that looks like in their life, Lord, whatever it is you're calling, God, send them forward without any regard. The enemy is going to send people out into the streets and everywhere else for destruction. Certainly, Lord, we can follow you for peace and unity if you send us. God, help us be obedient. Today is the day that we can voice a prayer for a spiritual battle of healing, a spiritual conquering of long-time strongholds that just need to be gone. Today is the day, God. Help us pray, and please, Lord, here in heaven, your dwelling place, and answer. We are your people. You are our God. Work at this time of invitation, God, in Jesus' name. Amen. As God leads you, you come forward or you stay where you're at, whatever he tells you to do.
Forgiveness.
Amen. I pray that the Lord spoke to you through His Word today, that He has encouraged you of the power of prayer, the importance of specific, particular prayer, and it's not just the words, but it's the heart behind it. Why? Why are we saying what we're saying? Why are we doing what we're doing? And we see King Solomon praying for his nation and saying, God, not just me, but all the people. We're all praying. We're all needing you, Lord. And so, God's people, we have to join together. We have to be united together for the front of the gospel. Thank you for being here today. Remember, we're going to sing this final song. You're not going to join hands or anything like that, but we're going to sing together. And after we're done, the rear can exit first. You guys can go out this way. And thank you so much for being with us today. Thank you for worshiping with us. And we're just grateful to have you in the house of the Lord today. All right, let's sing.
I'm undone by the mercy of Jesus.